So in this video, we will study about the various classification system we have for the distal and distal fracture. We have the various named classification, we have the AO classification, and we have the various named fractures. So we will discuss it one by one. Now starting with the first is the Frickman classification. So which defines the extra-articular and intra-articular fractures. Then we have the Milone classification, which is specifically for the intra-articular fractures. Then the AO classification for both extra and intra-articular. Then the Fernandez classification, which is based upon the mechanism of injury of the fracture. So we have these four named classifications, starting with the Frickman classification. Now, according to the Frickman classification, we classify it into, as we can see here, 8 types. So basically, it is based upon whether it is articular and which articular surface is involved, and whether ulna is involved or not. So starting with the type 1, so as we can see here, it is an extra articular with no ulna fracture. Then in type 2, it is with ulna fracture. Type 3, it is intra-articular and the fracture line is extending to the radiocarpal joint. And 3, it is without ulna fracture. 4, it is with ulna fracture. So it was intra-articular with fracture line extending into the radiocarpal joint. Without ulna fracture, with ulna fracture. Coming upon to the 5, it is the fracture line is extending into the distal radioulnar joint. So it is extending into a radioulnar joint. Here it was extending into the radiocarpal joint. Here it is extending into the radioulnar joint. So again it is without ulna fracture, with ulna fracture. Lastly, it is both extending into the radiocarpal and the radioulnar joint without ulna fracture, with ulna fracture. So it is extra articular without ulna, with ulna, radiocarpal without ulna, with ulna, radioulnar without ulna, with ulna, both radiocarpal and radioulnar without ulna and the with ulna fracture. So this is a Frickman classification which classifies into extra articular, intra articular, and then intra-articular, which intra-articular type it is involved. It is involving the radiocarpal joint or radio-ulnar joint. And whether ulna is involved or not involved. So this was about the Frickman classification. The second part classification is the Milone classification, which classifies only the intra-articular fracture. So as it is an intra-articular fracture, it says that we have the four parts. It says that every intra-articular fracture has 4 parts in which the radius is fractured. We have the lateral part, which is the radius toloid part. We have the 2 medial part. One is dorsal, one is volar. And we have the radial shaft part. So this is the Milone classification. So it says that we have the 4 parts. So we have the part 1, which is the radial styloid, then which is the lateral part, then we have the 2 medial part, dorsal and the volar. So this is the lateral view, and we finally have the radial shaft. So starting with the type 1 fracture, so type 1 it is says that it is a stable fracture without any displacement, and the fracture is divided into 4 parts and it can be reduced by close reduction. So it is stable fracture without displacement with characteristic fragment of the all the 4 types of the Milone classification. Coming upon to the type 2, it is unstable type. It is unstable type with die punch. Die punch means there is a displacement of the medial part of the medial part fragments. So die punch is basically the punching of the lunate fossa. The lunate bone punches upon on the medial part of the, so this is the die punch type, which is a lunate load. So lunate loads over the medial part, lunate fossa. So this is die punch fracture. So Milone type 2 is a form of a die punch fracture, which means that medial 2 fragments are displaced. We have the medial dorsal and the medial volar fragments. So these two are displaced. Then depending upon whether it is reducible or it is irreducible, we have the type 2A and 2B. So if it is reduced by close reduction, it is 2A. What all fracture cannot be reduced by close reduction? When we have a central impaction, when it is impacted and there is a bone loss, central impaction. So those are irreducible type of fractures. Coming back to type 3. Type 3, it is the spike type of fracture. So again, there is a unstable type of injury and a spike is created on the volar aspect. So on the volar aspect, a spike is created. So this spike is known to cause injury to the median nerve and the flexor tendons. So this is a type of spike fracture, which is unstable type. Coming upon to the type 4, which is a split type. In split type, there is a unstable and there is a rotation of the fragments, as we can see here. So we have they are splitted away. We have the rotated fragments, rotated medial and the lateral fragments. And lastly, we have the type 4, which is a severely comminuted, where more than 4 fragments are seen, which is known as explosion type of injury. So we have the 5 types. One was stable with 4 fragments, 2 with the die punch type of injury with the displacement of the medial fragments, whether it is reducible or it has an impaction which is non-reducible. Type 3, where is a spike is present over a palmar aspect or volar aspect, which has prosperity to cause injury to the flexor tendon and the median nerve. Type 4, where there is a rotation of the fragment, which is a split type. And type 5, which is explosion type of injury. So this is the Meloni classification, classifying the intra-articular fracture into 5 types, depending upon the displacement and the type of injury to these 4 parts. Coming upon to third type of classification, which is AO classification. So AO classifies into 3 types, A, B and C. So this is classification like any other intra-articular or metaphyseal classification, distal end of radius classification. So we have the type A, which is extra-articular, type B, which is a partial articular, and type C, which is a complete articular. So in type A, we have the A1, in which only ulna is fracture and radius is intact. As we can see here, only there is a fracture of the distal ulna. There is no fracture of the radius. This is type 1A. Coming upon to the type A2, where radius is fractured, it is extra-articular, and there is an impaction at the metaphyseal region. So radius is fractured, it is a simple type of fracture with impaction of the distal fragment into the proximal fragment. A3, where there is an extra-articular fracture, but there is a multi-fragmentation at the level of fracture, means it is a comminuted type of fracture. So A1 was only ulna fracture, A2 is the simple radius extra-articular, A3 is the multi-fragmented extra-articular radius. Coming upon to the type B, which is a partial articular. So B1 is the sagittal plane fracture of the radius, which means most likely a radius toloid fracture. So B1 is a radius toloid type of fracture, which is the fracture of radius in the sagittal plane. Then talking about the B2. So in B2, the radius is fractured in the coronal plane or the frontal plane, and it is dorsal rim which is a fractured, because it is a partial articular fracture. Only dorsal rim is fractured. In B3, only the volar rim is fractured. It is a fracture in the frontal or the coronal plane. Both fracture are in the coronal or the frontal plane, and either dorsal rim or the volar rim is fractured. Here the fracture was in the sagittal plane. And lastly, we have the complete articular fracture with C1, where the articular component is simple and metaphyseal component is also simple type of fracture. Here in C2, the articular is simple type of fracture, but the metaphyseal has multi-fragmentation. In C3, both the articular and the metaphyseal has multi-fragmentation. So this is about the AO classification of distal and radius fracture. Then talking about the last named classification, which is known as the Fernandez classification, which is based upon the mechanism of injury of the fracture. So talking of the Fernandez classification, we have the type 1, which is a bending type of fracture of the metaphyseal. The force acting upon the distal radius is the bending type, leading to the extra-articular fracture break at the metaphyseal level. Then type 2, it is shearing type of force, causing the partial articular type of fracture, either volar or dorsal. It is a basically shearing type of force at the distal radius. Then type 3, which is a compression fracture, where there is a compression injury of the joint surface. So this was extra-articular, this is partial articular, this is intra-articular. Compression of the joint surface. The force is the compressive force. Then type 4, it is avulsion type of injury where there is a radiocarpal dissociation. So again, as we go in the types, the mechanism and the trauma also increases. So we go into the high energy injuries. So here it is a radiocarpal dislocation with avulsion type of the injuries. And lastly, we have the type 5, which is a comminuted and a high velocity with multi-fragmentation at the articular and the metaphyseal region. So we have type 1, which is a bending type, extra-articular at the metaphyseal level. Type 2, which is shearing type, which is a partial articular. Then we have the type 3, which is a compressive type at the joint surface. Type 4 is the avulsion type and the dislocation of the radiocarpal joint. And type 5 is a combined or comminuted type of both articular and the metaphyseal. So this is the Fernandez type of the classification. Now talking about lastly about the various named fracture, we have for the distal radius fracture. So type 1, as we have discussed, it is an intra-articular fracture with displacement of the medial articular surface, which represent the depression of the lunate fossa. So this is the because of lunate load, it is known as the die punch fracture. The second is a Barton fracture. Barton fracture is basically a intra-articular fracture where there is a dislocation of the radiocarpal joint, and it can be either a dorsal Barton or a volar Barton depending upon the fracture fragment that is created. So here it is created volarly, so it is a volar Barton, and there is dislocation of the radiocarpal joint. So Barton fracture is basically a dislocation of the radiocarpal joint with intra-articular fracture of distal radius with either a volar or a dorsal component. And then we have the Schoffer's fracture, which is a radial stoloid, isolated radial stoloid type of fracture. So we have die punch, Barton, Schoffer, and then the very commonly used is Coley's and the Smith type of fracture. So both of them are extra-articular fractures at the metaphyseal region, and they are divided depending upon the displacement of the distal fragment. If it is a displaced dorsally, it is a Coley's fracture. If the distal fragment is displaced volarly, it is a Smith fracture. So Coley's fracture is basically an extra-articular fracture of distal radius with the displacement of the distal fragment dorsally. And Smith is an extra-articular fracture of distal radius with volar displacement of the distal fragment. So this was about the classification of the various classification system we have for the distal and radius fractures. Thank you.